for the closing keynote. If you're attending that one, the closing keynote, please go as quickly as you can after this session because we want to start that one on time. There's a 10-minute gap between those. And for the final talk, what can be better than to share the pain of another fellow human being? So please welcome Tobias Modig.
I walk down the street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It still takes forever to find a way out. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place. But it isn't my fault, and it still takes a long time to get out. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it there. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. I walk down a different street. This poem called There's a Hole in My Sidewalk by Portia Nelson, it reminds me quite well about how I have behaved during my career. I have walked into a trap, and I have recovered myself, just to find myself doing the same mistake over and over again. But for each time, I have got myself a little more experience. So finally, I have not even chosen the path that leads toward this pitfall. My hope is that you, after the next 10 or 15 minutes, will learn to recognize when you are heading towards my pitfalls, so you hopefully can avoid them. Welcome to Beware My Pitfalls. My name is Tobias Modig. I'm a consultant at Citerus, and I have failed. I have failed hard. I have failed often. I have failed so huge that one of my colleagues actually once called our common project an epic failure. I started to think a little bit about this. What's a failure? And what's an epic failure? So I turned myself to the almighty search engine, and he gave me two pictures. A failure, it can be described a little bit like this. Well, it's not a total disaster. This will probably be fixed in a day or two, and that train is on the right track again. An epic failure, on the other hand, this is something completely different. This is not something you fix overnight. It will take time. It will cost you a lot of money. And as a worst case scenario, you might not even be able to fix it at all. So, if I try to transfer these pictures into development projects, what's a failure and an epic failure in that context? For me, a failure, that could be like you miss some deadline or, well, you make use of all the budget halfway into the project. An epic failure, on the other hand, that could be that you and your whole development team is thrown out of the project, or that the project is closed down after 3 years of development. And believe me, I have been to all of these situations. So, let me bring you into the context a little bit here. Was there any similarities between these failing projects? Well, since that's a rhetorical question, yes, there was. We were using Scrum. We were building Java applications. Web-based applications with a lot of external dependencies, with web services and SOAP. There were big companies involved with developers all over the world in different time zones. This made us rely pretty hard on external tools, on communication like chat, phone conferences, and an electronic scrum board. And as a bonus, this guy was in all of the projects. But actually, sorry about that. Actually, I choose to ignore all of this. Of course, you can succeed under these circumstances. Maybe it wasn't the perfect preconditions, but it is possible. So who can I blame then? Well, of course, the unripe, immature customer, right? I guess you all know you can always, always blame the customer. Or? Nah. The truth is, I can't blame anything. It wasn't the techniques that failed. It wasn't the method that failed. It was we, as a team, that failed. I will therefore quickly share the 5 biggest mistakes I believe we did during these failing projects. So, I jump right into pitfall number 1, the water scrum fall. What I mean by this is that we have a development team who tries to be agile. In our case, we used Scrum, while the rest of the organization is still working in a waterfall process. For instance, one of these projects, it was preceded by nearly 2 years of requirements work, where the system, it was specified into details and all was broken down into user stories. These user stories was then dispensed into X number of iterations just to make sure that everything would fit in with that agreed deadline and budget. And this was everything before the development team was in place. So what is this? It's a waterfall, right? So, of course, that project bumped into all the problems that comes with common waterfall projects. Pitfall number 2, the product owner. We had extremely hard to get any concrete information from the product owner. In one case, it was pretty obvious, since we actually didn't have any. In another case, the product owner role was replaced by a product owner group with representative from all possible and impossible stakeholders. This had the consequence that no one in the group dared to take any own decisions, so everything was always raised to the next planned product owner group meeting. Meanwhile, we were coding in blindness. We guessed our way forward, and we didn't really get any feedback until the demo at best, but usually when the bug reports started to drop in from the acceptance testers. Pitfall number 3. The mega stories. Our stories were gigantic. It was actually pretty common that 2-3 developers worked with one single story during the whole sprint. Stories of that size, they were pretty hard to estimate, so it was quite usual that we didn't actually finish that single story. And in those cases, well, we delivered no value at all. And those times we actually did finish the story, there was certainly no time to test and fix eventual bugs within the sprint. So those kind of stuff fell over to the next sprint and delayed that as well. And as an extra bonus feature, it was more or less useless to try to keep track of the progress, since nothing was done until the sprint's last trembling hours. Pitfall number 4, the push. Already at the sprint planning, the Scrum Master handed out the user stories to each and every developer, stories that we then was responsible for. This didn't build a team, it rather created a group of individuals who put their own task in front of the team. So, collaborations and, juggling of ideas, that became a personal burden. So when someone asked for help, it was, everybody just sat silent so they wouldn't jeopardize their own story. Pitfall number 5, no Slack. Our sprints were maximized by stories. It actually went so far that we were persuaded to bring in a couple of more stories just to keep track with that the schedule someone had added into an Excel spreadsheet like 6 months ago. This made us become world champion at quick and dirty code, and every unplanned event, it hit the sprint pretty hard. And there was certainly no time for any long-term improvement, so the progress of the team, it slowly decreased in line with the growing technical depth. So, I have now gone through what I believe was the 5 biggest mistakes we did during my failing projects. This was quite fluffy, right? And it was actually no news or something revolutionary, but I think that since I run into these kind of problems over and over again, I thought it was still valuable to bring up these kind of concerns once more. As I see it, it all derives from the same main problem, namely that we try to pick the best or the easiest parts from the agile cake instead of running the whole concept. It wasn't just Scrum, just because we had a Scrum Master and morning meetings, and it wasn't agile, just because we moved story cards on the board, and had demos every second week. All of this, well, it was good stuff, but it didn't help us to succeed. And in the middle of this, there I was. I was starting to feel bad. I was getting a stomach ache. But still, I rolled up my sleeves, and with a madman stubbornness, I tried to row this sinking boat forward when I instead should have spoken up. The right thing to do was, of course, to try to make a change, not to work even harder down that dead-end street. So my final advice to you as a developer is do not get caught in bad practices. Dare to speak up if there is something that doesn't work right. And make sure you chop up that whole agile cake. Otherwise, you will be joining me in my pit. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all. Time for the closing keynote in the big room.